The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Another parable Jesus put before the crowds. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed that someone took and sowed in his field. It's the smallest of all seeds, but when it is grown, it is the greatest of shrubs and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air come and make nests in its branches. He told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and mixed in with 3 measures of flour until all of it was leavened. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which someone found and hid. Then in his joy, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. On finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and caught fish of every kind. When it was full, they drew it ashore, sat down, and put the good into baskets, but threw out the bad. So it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you understood all this? They answered, yes. And he said to them, therefore, every scribe who has been trained for the kingdom of heaven is like the master of a household who brings out of his treasure what is new and what is old. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, Lord Christ.
Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and meditations of our hearts be always acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our salvation. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. So the only way the Gospels truly make sense and Jesus ends up being crucified is if we understand that Jesus was subversive, that Jesus really was not a friend of the state, and that people recognized the threat that he was, and so they violently killed him. It's ironic then that Jesus has been so domesticated over the years and that Christianity itself has become so mainstream. And at least some, and they tend to be younger, think that the current decline of the church is a good thing because they see it as representing the fact that the church is once again at odds with the empire, that the values that the church holds are by and large different than the larger values that society has come to hold. And that hostility is what is behind the decline of the church. Be that as it may, today's Gospels give us great insight into that subversive nature of Jesus, that Jesus really was at odds in a great many ways with the status quo. Neither was not a friend of the right or the left, was not a friend of the religious conservatives or the religious liberals, really in many ways questioned all of them, and called all of them into account. So he tells these parables, and these parables, again, are subversive, and that subversiveness can be seen in the images themselves. That first parable, the parable of the mustard seed, we hear that and we think, what a nice story. Small things come in, or big things come in small packages. Often big things have a small start. But the truth of the matter is what Jesus chooses as an image, the mustard tree, this was a weed, and it was seen as undesirable, and it was the kind of thing that was invasive, that would take over valuable land, you know, in the Mideast, where fertile ground, wet ground is at a premium, weeds were particularly bad things. And so for Jesus to take a mustard seed, a weed, and make that the hero of the story, that was a pretty radical thing to do. And the second parable, and it's the only other one I'll mention here, but you can do this with all of them, Jesus speaks about leaven, and we think leaven's a good thing because we like leavened bread. We like yeasty bread. I like yeasty bread. I like donuts. I like pizza crust. I like sweet rolls. I like, you know, on and on and on. But in Jesus' day, leaven was a bad thing, and leaven was used to show how it is that evil taints everything it touches, like leaven influences everything it touches. Put a little loaf into the flour and bread, it impacts everything. It was used as a way of understanding how evil taints everything it touches. And so leaven was a bad, bad thing. That's why, for instance, the Passover meal, they would have used unleavened bread. And again, in this story, Jesus uses leaven as sort of the good guy, as the hero in the story, as the one who makes the point. Leaven in this story is a very good thing. And part of what I think is going on here is that Jesus is calling people to understand that life in the kingdom of God, it requires us to see differently. It requires us to see things that other people do not see. It requires us to see things that sometimes other people don't want us to see. And then seeing things differently, it requires us to act differently, to behave in different ways, to persevere in ways that we might not persevere, to invest ourselves in a future that other people might scoff at. So the gospel calls us to see differently, and that can begin with how we see a weed, because a weed is really nothing more than something that culture has determined as being undesirable. And when you think of a lawn, for instance, which a perfectly manicured green lawn is something that our culture says is great. And if you have a lawn, and if you don't keep your lawn green and well manicured, and if you live in an area with the homeowners association, you're probably going to be fine. So again, this is no small part of our social strata. Part of what binds us together is our lawns. You know, the uniformity of suburbia, the uniformity of our cultural life is expressed in the way we all keep our lawns. And if somebody was to let their lawn go to pot, was to let weeds grow up and so on and so forth, they would be fine if there's a homeowners association. If there's no homeowners association, neighbors would probably in some way, shape, or form try to influence this person so they don't bring down the resale values. But there is another name for a lawn, and another name for a lawn is a green desert, because a lawn is not friendly to life. A perfectly manicured green lawn is not friendly to life. Grass has very shallow root, and so it takes a ton of water. In a world where people don't have water, to waste water on a lawn is perhaps the ultimate luxury. Lawns take a ton of chemicals. To have a green lawn, you got to kill things. I mean, that's the only way to do it, because that takes chemical applications, and killing the things like the grubs and so on and so forth that would live in there gets passed up the food chain and kills all kinds of other things. It's a technological marvel in terms of creating a perfectly manicured green lawn. Weeds, on the other hand, are adapted to survive, and so they send roots down deep, so they don't need a lot of water. They survive in times there is no water, and because a weed can survive with no water, all kinds of animals come to depend on weeds. They know they can eat the food of weeds, they know they can eat the leaves of weeds, and so weeds promote life in part because they send that taproot down deep. If you've ever pulled a dandelion, I think most of us have, we all should have somewhere along the line, you know that the dandelions have, you know, probably the person who explained to you how to pull dandelions explained to you, you gotta get the taproot, right? Special device, and if you don't get the taproot, and it's about as far underground as it's above the ground, that weed will just come right back. A weed is adapted to survive. And so weeds promote life. And then the other things about weeds is they proliferate profusely. They spread their seeds abundantly, or they'll send runders under the ground. But however they do it, weeds reproduce themselves in huge abundance. And again, part of the reason they do that is because since they're survivors, animals depend on them, and so they eat them. And so weeds have to be reproduced in great proportions so that they can keep ahead of all the things that are eating them. So again, weeds promote life. And just for instance, poison ivy is one of the best things you could plant for birds. And not particularly good for people, but birds love the berries on poison ivy. So if you just wanted to plant a yard for birds, you'd plant a ton of poison ivy. And the reason you may see poison ivy popping up in your yard, and I see it popping up all over my yard, is because birds eat the berries out in the woods, and they come in the yard, and they pass those berries, and that's why poison. They love poison ivy berries. Milkweed, monarch butterflies. Part of the reason monarchs are in danger of actual extinction is because we've eradicated milkweed. We said, you know, this is bad, and these, but with it goes a whole niche of our ecosystem. So as we think about that, it may well be that what Jesus was suggesting in using a weed as his principal character in this first parable is that people in the kingdom are people who go deep. They're people who have a deep taproot. They go deep. And we just live in a day and age which we don't need any more shallow people. I'm sorry. We just don't need any more people swimming in the shallow end of the pool. We need people who go deep. We need people who think deeply, who reflect deeply, who will prayerfully approach life, who will read Scripture, learn from Scripture, allow Scripture to shape them rather than allowing contemporary culture to shape them, because that's part of what our problem is. And again, when that happens, person is neither going to be a friend of the right or the left, because they're not just going to spout the party line. They're not just going to be mindless parrots that just say what they think everybody wants them to say, or whatever their political persuasion is. And you know, we need people who are going to be quiet instead of people who are going to mouth off. We need people who are going to listen instead of going to speak uninformed whatever. We need people who are going to be prayerful and reflective rather than just embracing the sort of superficiality which so characterizes our culture these days. And then we need people who are going to be proliferant in doing good, in spreading themselves around, if you will. And part of the secret of Jesus' success, part of the secret of the kingdom, is that Jesus just did so much good work. He was always giving himself away. He just did so much good work. He touched so many lives that even when they killed Jesus, they couldn't kill the Jesus movement. Now, of course, Jesus was resurrected, and that had a lot to do with that as well. But the fact of the matter is, even before Jesus was resurrected, there were still people doing good work, because Jesus had touched so many people's lives. There were still people who were keeping that ball going. And so what happens in the kingdom is we just do good everywhere we can, to everyone we can, to anyone we can. And everybody might not appreciate it, but some people will. And it catches. And then the life of the kingdom, the life of goodness and kindness and of receiving grace from God so that we can give the grace of God, share the grace of God, that begins to pass itself on. So it begins with seeing differently, seeing a weed perhaps as a beautiful thing, something that promotes life, something that should be valued in a yard instead of eradicated from a yard at all costs. And you might not be able to do much with your front yard, but your backyard, you can go crazy usually. Homeowners don't really care. My backyard is just a jungle, but it is full of life. It's a really cool place to be. So we see differently. And we see differently, then we behave differently. We act differently. This past week, we did Vacation Bible School. That's why we have all these wonderful decorations up. It was just one of the best weeks of the year. And over that past week, I sort of watched Ashley, who is our children's minister on staff. I watched how many hours she was working. And I'll guarantee you, the last 2 weeks, she worked an easy 80 hours a week. I mean, you know, she was here every single day. She was here most of the day, and she was at home working on decorations when she wasn't here. So there were a lot of hours. And of course, we only pay her for a fraction of that. And so you might say, well, why would somebody work so many hours when you only pay them for a little bit? Well, they believe something's important, and so they invest themselves in that thing they believe important, whether they're paid or not. They see differently, so they act differently. But the truth is, it wasn't just Ashley. So, for instance, we had a police officer, Sergeant Johnson, who was here, and he was here every day. He was here as a crew leader. That meant he got here about 4 or 4:30 and left about 9. So he was here 4.5, 5 hours every day. He works 50, 55 hours, 60 hours as a sergeant around town in a very demanding job, and then he was here 20, 25 hours after that. So there's a 75-hour week right there, right? And not just him. I mean, the Bellamys, for instance, they both work full-time. She was a staff leader. He played in the band for the week. They both not only have a full-time job, they have 2 kids. And so on top of that, you know, 25 hours. So why do people do that? They see differently, they value different things, they behave differently. I was driving to work the other day, and a Bentley pulled up next to me. And a Bentley's a beautiful car. It's a beautiful car. But you have to see the world differently to invest yourself in such a way that you can drive a Bentley. And each to their own. But if you follow Jesus, Jesus may call us. If I follow Jesus, Jesus may call me to invest my life in such a way that I behave differently and achieve other things rather than this. And really, for Christians, it's pretty simple. If we can't imagine Jesus doing something, then we really have no business doing it ourselves. A Christian, fundamentally, follower of Jesus, and that's sort of where it starts and ends, actually. And it's not just in church, but it's also in the world. Isaac and I were having lunch just last week, and this is actually Isaac's last week with us, as sad as that is. I personally have tremendously enjoyed Isaac's presence with us. He's been a real blessing to me. He's done great work here, been very, very good. And as I've said publicly in each of the services, Isaac, we want you to come back next summer.
Lord willing.
No pressure, but we'd love for you to come back. If you haven't taken Isaac out to eat yet, haven't asked him for a meal, this is your last week to do so. He is of that age where, and many of you remember this, when you don't have enough money for food, so you just kind of scrounge around the edges. I've been there. You've probably been there. I've done peanut butter and jelly for a long time. Many people were almond. So your meal actually really does make a difference to him. So if you haven't taken him out yet, if you haven't, this is the week. Take him out. Treat him to a meal. But we were at lunch, and we were talking with our waitress, and I see a waitress. Who's a waitress? A waitress is somebody who serves us. But we talked with her a little bit. She was a young girl, and turns out she'd come over from Bolivia, and she had only been here 5 months. She'd left her mother there, so a long way off, hard to leave your mom. Her dad was here. Her dad was in poor health. Taking care of her dad, her job. She was very lonely, didn't know anybody, have any. And as we talked, I stopped seeing her as a waitress, and I, this probably happens to you too. It was more like seeing her as my daughter. You know, she's somebody's daughter. And my heart began to just break, and I just thought, well, you know, what can I do? There's got to be something I can do. When you see differently, you behave differently. There's got to be something I can do that enhances her chance of success in life. And so I said to Isaac, you know, what should we leave her as a tip? I mean, that's something we can do. And Isaac was very prayerful, thought about it, prayed about it for a moment, and then said, I'll tell you what, let's give her double the bill. So we doubled the price of the meal, and that instead of 20%, it was 200%, and that's what we left her as a tip. And that's one of the reasons we follow Jesus, do things differently. And we're going to teach Financial Peace University, which teaches us not just how to be free from debt, but teaches us how to use money well. And so if you make good decisions financially, you have margin in your life. And if you have margin in your life, what that means is you're not just always servicing debt or having to work to make money, but you can use your money to do good things for people. You got extra. So we could pass that on. 2 days later, I went back to the same restaurant. Didn't mean to, didn't think I would, but somebody wanted to go there. Ended up with the same waitress, and I thought, oh, man, these $100 lunches are going to get expensive, you know, in a hurry. Holy cow. But she was just so grateful. She was just so, so grateful. And, you know, and it just, I know it blessed her, but it really blessed me. When we see differently, we act differently, we invest differently, we behave differently. That's what the kingdom is really all about. May we be kingdom people, not just on Sunday mornings, but when it matters most, the whole week long. Amen.